I'm actually not sure that I can even introduce myself. I'm so beyond excited for this screening and panel. It has been such a long time coming. I think we've pitched the lovely team at CBS some version of this every year for the past 10 festivals. Is that possible?
At this point, everything is 10 years to me. But for those that don't know, I'm Jennifer Morgan, Director of Programming for ATX Festival, and this is our co-founder, Caitlin McFarland. But you can also refer to us as the captains of the Kings fan club.
Yes, as two people who were slash are obsessed with The Good Wife, Brain Dead, Evil, and pretty much every strange and wonderful thing that comes out of their brains, The Good Fight is always at the top of our list.
While we're incredibly bummed that we can't be with this group in Austin right now, we have spent the last week fantasizing about starting a wine and bourbon club with Christine Baranski and Audra McDonald. So there's that.
Yeah, I thought I'd woo them by going ahead and pouring myself a bourbon. Is it working? Think about it. Tell us later. It's fine.
It is Friday night, but it has also been a long year, so no judgments. But seriously, we are so thrilled to have this brilliant group here to talk about that amazing season 5 premiere and all things The Good Fight.
So with that, we're going to get off your screen and hand it over to our moderator, Eric Deggans from NPR.
Hi, Eric.
Hey, I am seriously bummed. Nobody told me I could bring bourbon to this.
Friday night. I would have
really made sure I had a good time. Anyway, thank you guys so much for allowing me to moderate this discussion. I too am a huge fan of The Good Fight. And so it is my pleasure to welcome all of you to this discussion with the cast and producers of The Good Fight. So let's start out by introducing our all-star panel here. We've got co-creators and executive producers, Robert and Michelle King. We've got stars Christine Baranski and Audra McDonald. And we have new cast additions, Mandy Patinkin and Charmaine Bingwa. Thanks so much for joining us, guys. This is just a huge treat for me. I've been a huge fan of both The Good Wife and The Good Fight, so much so I accidentally call The Good Fight The Good Wife sometimes when I'm talking about it. I get so confused. But I will confess, so I'm the TV critic for NPR, just so if people don't know. And I'm a TV critic, which means I'm a little dense sometimes. So before we talk about the new season, I have got to ask you guys, what the heck is Memo 618? I watched every episode and I still don't get it.
Memo 618, we were watching all the events leading up to the first impeachment hearing of the last president. And it was amazing how many people were served subpoenas and said, yeah, no, I don't want to go. And it was like, I don't remember that when we were growing up. When you were served with a subpoena, it was an optional. So what we wanted was this H22-like memo. It's based on our daughter's birthday, June 18th. And so Memo 618 was a memo that is like a get out of jail free card for the rich and pop and powerful. So just this tendency that all these people who didn't want to be testifying, didn't want to be sued, wanted to be released and not bothered because they had business to tend to, they could serve this memo and it was over. So it's hopefully fictional, but when the more we looked at the Office of Legal Counsel, which is a real thing, the more we found there were elements that served into that mindset of people who are too important to be served with what regular people, I don't know if we're that regular, but regular people like me anyway, not these other good fine folks, would have to go and testify.
All right. Okay. So finally, my curiosity is sated. And, you know, I loved last season's episodes. And last season started with a standalone episode, the episode where Diane wakes up in this alternate reality where Trump lost the election. And you guys are doing something similar with this fifth season where you have a standalone episode where you catch us up on all these things that have happened since the show's been away. From the death of George Floyd to the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Can you talk a little bit about why you decided to do another standalone episode to kick off this season? And give us talk a little bit about why you handled all the storylines the way you did and what happens there.
Well, mainly it comes down to we love these characters. And we realized before we could start with any story, we needed to know, and we hoped the audience would also want to know, what did they live through in this last year? I mean, this pandemic year was so difficult for everybody. What was it like for Liz and Diane and everyone else? And so we wanted to do that in one episode to catch us up to where we wanted to start this season.
So we're playing off the trope of modern TV is the previously on, which is usually a 1 to 2 minute awful little cut together bit about what you missed, but ours is 50 minutes with the main title coming after the 50 minutes of previously's on, which is what happened to everybody while you were enjoying your pandemic time. What happened to them?
Okay. And can you talk a little bit? I mean, we're going to see some beloved characters make their final bows during this episode. And I'm speaking in particular of Delroy Lindo's Adrian Bozeman and Coach Jumbo's Luca. So can you talk a little bit about how you decided to wrap up their storylines in this episode and why you decided to handle it that way?
Well, I can tell you that we would have handled it differently had the production in the world not shut down last season. You know, so because we stopped filming in episode 7 instead of taking it through 10, we weren't able to wrap up and give those characters the proper goodbye they deserved. So both Delroy and Kush were generous enough to agree that they cared enough about the characters in the production to come back and allow us to say a proper goodbye.
And that led us to only want to kill one of those characters. So you have to guess which one.
Guessing, is it the actor you like the least? Oh, anyway. So, Christine, I want to turn to you because you've been playing this character for a while now. You were in the 5th season of The Good Fight and 7 seasons on The Good Wife. And I wonder at this point, are there things that you're still learning about Diane Lockhart? Are there new depths every season? Tell me how you keep it fresh, given that this is a character you know so well.
Well, she's kept fresh by the fact that she's living in the present tense and living through this moment in history. And the lovely thing for me, the great gift as an actress slash human being, is that I have been able to stick my anger, frustration, confusion, delusion, exasperation, rage at Donald Trump. I stick it in a handbag on my way out the door after I've watched MSNBC for about an hour and a half, and I bring it to work, and then I unpack that handbag and I get to use all of that playing Diane. So it never feels, I never feel I'm in danger of it not being fresh. If anything, I stay awake because of this character. I stay awake as an actress and as a person because, as I said, she's always been a character who's tried to, you know, fight the good fight and keep her balance in a world that keeps spinning out of control. And she grapples head on with issues. And so, thanks to the King's brilliant writing, I've had this marvelous ride. You know, every episode is a great adventure for me.
Yeah, and I guess so. One of the storylines is going to involve the some of the folks at the firm challenging Diane to say, you know, perhaps a white person shouldn't be one of the biggest partners at a black dominated law firm. And that's, you know, one of the things that you guys do so well is you turn the debates and the conversation that we're having in the real world on their head. And it sounds like this is an example of that. Can you talk a little bit about how that storyline plays out for Diane and how it may be a little funhouse mirror reflection of the discussions that we're having in the real world about race?
Are you asking Christine or us?
Whoever wants to handle it. I thought I might ask Christine.
No, I wonder what you're going to say, Christine. The difficulty about subjects of race, politics, international affairs is it's often easy to demonize the other side. And one of the best things about TV shows is you tend to feel you know those people. It's not like a movie where you sit with them for 2 hours or less. When you sit with them for that long, and so when you find characters like Liz played by Audra and Diane played by Christine on the opposite ends of things, it kind of rips at your insides because you actually do have to kind of walk in their shoes because you walked in their shoes for so long. So I think that's one of the most fun things about addressing the complicated subject is it doesn't there. I, at least in this case, I didn't think there was an easy answer. I mean, I think we're still dealing with it with the season. We have two more episodes to write, and I don't think we quite know. Sometimes the writer's room doesn't quite know what they feel on some of these issues. On some they do, by the way. But also, you know, it's difficult when you know these people.
And I don't know if we're going to have any resolution. I think the show speaks to how characters, how intelligent human beings are trying to find the language of reconciliation and trying to figure it out. From Diane's perspective, you know, the show began with her losing all her money and the only firm that would take her was an African-American firm. And so this deep friendship and work relationship she had with Bozeman was something very moving to her, very valuable. And then her friendship with Liz, and these are her colleagues. So she, I think in that you do have a white woman in an African-American law firm and she's a partner, there's no way we're not going to address that issue this season. And I can only say that from Diane's perspective, having been a woman who had to fight that underdog fight for all of her life and then losing her money and having to start again, she fought ageism. She's like, no, wait a minute, I finally got to this place and now, you know, I'm fighting for it again. So it's very interesting. And of course, working with Audra, you know, I think we're going to, it's going to be just a very interesting dance and we're living the questions. You know, we don't have answers. We're walking question marks.
Definitely. And Audra, I wanted to bring you into this because with Adrian gone, I'm wondering how does the dynamic change between Liz and Diane, and now we have a firm that's not only Black dominated, but led by women.
Well, I think for Liz, as much as I think she was always trying to prove to Adrian that, you know, she didn't need him in as an authoritative figure in her life anymore, even though he was her ex-husband, he had also been, you know, had worked with her father and had been a teacher of hers. So there is a lot of history there that in some ways, once Adrian leaves the firm and then sort of charges Liz with, you know, you've got to take care of this firm and make sure that it stands for what it's supposed to stand for. Liz is having to step into this even more of a leadership position. And as the top Black person at this firm, she also, Black lawyer at this firm, she then has to step into this thorny issue. I think she very much likes the idea of the firm being led by women, but understands the optics and the necessity to make sure that it is not a firm that is in any way being dominated by someone white. And so there's a difficult dance that she's having to do because she also very much respects Diane, has come to lean on Diane, and they have a complicated but a deep friendship, I think, and they've been through a lot together. So it's a very tricky spot. And again, it's what we're living, you know, right now. It's what we're living in the world right now. And we're what I always say about the Kings is they step right up to the line. They don't pussyfoot around it. They don't say, well, let's deal with this. Or let's go over here. Or let's make this fine, whatever. They step right up to the line and say, this is what's happening. And they shine their light on it in all of its guts and glory and all of it. And they're not afraid to get messy. And that's what happens in this season. It gets messy.
Now, when you said they step right up to the line, I couldn't help it. What flashed in my mind was a final episode where the final scene is Jeffrey Epstein's, you know, equipment. I could not believe that you did that.
We thought there would be a couple more episodes after that. I mean, yeah. I think it would be the plan.
I didn't realize that'd be the final note of the season. But in an odd way, you know, it makes sense in some kind of odd way. So Mandy Patinkin, I'm going to pull you into this conversation now, sir. Been a fan of yours for a long time. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about this character that you're playing, Hal Wackner. a judge in something called a 9 3/4 court. Can you talk a little bit about this character? Nope. Oh, okay. Next question. can you sing a little bit from the
how many of you know, what do you want to hear?
Give us a Broadway tune then.
Yeah, what would you hear? Anything. I'm learning about this guy every minute, every day. I think we're all learning about him. It's fun. I don't want to give it away. I don't like giving things away. I don't like talking about the character. I'm just having a good time. And I love, I've known Audra and Christine forever. And Christine and I go way back. So I guess the greatest thing for me about the whole thing is whenever I'm with Christine, I'm about 40 years younger. Is that right? Am I got the math right, Christine? Because yes, I look at her, it's the same way she did in 1984. And it's like a time tunnel for me. And I'm just, I'm a much younger person than the little square on Zoom is showing you.
What do you have to say about your work? What's amazing is there was a scene you guys did, and it was like Jane Curtin playing the judge. It was Audra in there. It was Danny Burstein. And I forget everybody else, but it was like Broadway.
Jesse Tyler Ferguson.
Right. It was like Broadway just spilled out into this stage in Greenpoint. It was kind of amazing. Yeah. It was fun to see you guys all play together because there was this real sharpness, but also ability to kind of have fun and play with it too.
And I do want to say something about that the Kings have done, you know, a glorious thing here. Maybe they've done it the whole time for 12 years, but I'm new to this, and the number of actors who we all know have been out of work in New York and not only actors, but crew members and, you know, people in the various unions, they have employed every imaginable human being they possibly can that has suffered in this industry from the Broadway world, the New York theater world, and they've brought them into the fold of this show, which earns them a place in heaven as far as we're all concerned. The work that Christine and Audra and the Kings have done is just, you know, I bow down, I kiss their feet, and it's beautiful. You see all these people everybody, when we were young, Christine, remember everybody used to say, well, I wish it was like London, because everybody in London, they work all day long and they're in movies or TV things, and then they go to the theater at night.
That's
sort of happening here. So it's,
We're like an acting repertory company, because so many people, for instance, Jane Curtin, she's been judge. Dennis O'Hare, he's come back. He flew in from Paris to be our judge again. We have, you know, people who have been guests who just, they come back and we're happy to see them. They'll always have a home here. We love to recycle actors.
Well, and of course, you know, the question is, when are we getting a musical episode? Come on, Robert Michelle, yes. Come on.
It is bordering on the criminal, because one of the days, and again, it was Danny Burstein and Ben Vereen was there, Mandy and Christine and Audra. I mean, it was sinful, frankly, that we didn't have musical numbers.
So Charmaine, I don't want to go too long without bringing you in. So perhaps you could tell us a little bit about your character too, Carmen. She's a young lawyer, right? What can you tell her about her storyline?
Yeah, Carmen, she's from like a tough part of town. So I feel like she grew up around people who, you know, she didn't have a direct route via Ivy League colleges to her career in law. And I feel like she grew up around people who were oppressed by the system. So early on, she made a decision to make the system work for her, which is interesting because she uses those same street smarts to negotiate her life at the firm and her way through the law, which is fertile ground for a lot of interesting things to happen. But my favorite way of thinking about her is she's often playing chess while everyone else around her is playing checkers, because she is strategic, she's unpredictable, she is unconventional, and yeah, she's definitely like an underdog.
All right. That sounds, I can't wait to see more of her.
Can I be in a scene with her, please? Can you put me in a scene with her?
I know, right? And John
Lithgow. Coming up, 9 and 10. It's all about you two.
He comes in at the last minute and now he's making orders like he's ordered takeout. What is going on here?
Yeah, let's look at a musical scene. Sunday.
I just ordered up like a Sunday.
Okay.
But she's scene a lot with of fun.
Then a scene with Christine. And singing. Don't forget singing. We need that yes. too. Charmaine, I didn't want to take you too far back in time, but I looked at your bio and I saw you're from Australia and you're the first woman of color to win a scholarship named in Heath Ledger's name. Could you yes. talk a little bit about that? That sounds amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm so proud, like any actor would be, to have their name in the same sentence as Heath. It's a wonderful scholarship that Australia gives to one person under the age of 35 with the biggest potential for a global career. And it's a wonderful package where you're, you know, it really spotlights you to the industry, and there's a bunch of training and perks you receive. And I've grown very close to Heath Ledger's family. We're actually from the same hometown, Perth, where I spent a lot of time in the pandemic. So it's just such a wonderful gift. Heath had such a generosity of spirit and obviously the highest standard in his work. So it really helped me get on the radar of a lot of people and eventually meet the Kings, which I'm very fortuitous introduction.
I was gonna say, given your role in The Good Wife, it seems like they made the right choice. We're recording this just a couple of days before the 1 year anniversary of the death of George Floyd. And we have seen this intensified reckoning over civil rights and the video of his murder. We've seen the effect of that kind of ripple through the TV industry. And I'm wondering, I guess this is a question for the Kings, but if someone else from the cast wants to speak up too, that'd be great. How do you think that has affected the storylines that you're writing now? And also, how do you think that may affect the TV industry going forward?
Well, we touched a bit on how it impacted the storylines. I don't imagine we would be talking about Liz and Diane's struggle with one another in the partnership had we not been where we are now. In terms of impact on the industry, that will be a great conversation to have in 2 years. Mm-hmm. Because I think it's going to be that long until we know whether, I mean, this is just my cynical point of view, how sure. much this talk is real. Because 3 years ago, people were very, very interested in Me Too and what that meant about women. And you don't hear much of that talk anymore. So while I hope the conversation will be ongoing in several years, it's a little bit, we'll see. But I'd love to hear other people's points of view.
I just want to point out that it was just very, such an interesting context, because I remember sitting next to Audra when we were all waiting for the verdict to come in. And it sounds like a lot of the people on the show have been there for historical moments and just how much our hearts were in our mouth when that was happening and how relieved we were to actually hear it. So it felt very kind of symbolic to be on set that day and be able to talk to each other about it.
I would also say, so many people have said that the Kings have a crystal ball, somehow they can read the future, but it's uncanny that this show began and it was Michelle's idea, why not set it in an African-American law firm? So let me just say, we have a set that seriously employs Black actors, and on any given day you will look around on the cast and the crew and see just an example of extraordinary diversity and talent. And a set that really gets along, and we do very well. You know, I think that, you know, I'm very proud of where we are as a show.
I think I would add to that, Christine. I would add to that as well that because the Kings are so willing to absolutely talk about what's going on and write about what's happening in the world and write about it in all of its, like I said before, all of its guts and glory. They also walk the walk, and on very much so on our set, as Christine has pointed out, to the point where you know, we've, you know, we all have done other jobs, and I've gotten so spoiled being on our set and seeing the diversity of color, of gender, in all aspects of the set, not just in front of the camera, but behind the camera as well. In fact, this season, one of our episodes is being directed by Nikki James, who's an incredible Black actress, a Tony Award-winning actress. She's done a lot of work for Robert Michelle King as an actress, and now she is directing the shows as well. So the Kings, along with Brooke Kennedy, our great exec producer, very much understand that you can't just, you know, pontificate about these things and then not show up in meaningful ways. And they're doing that here on the set.
And can I just say, it is the writer's room too. The writer's room is the one always pushing the envelope. Often it's very nice when showrunners get all the glory, but it really is an amazing collaborative effort. We would do everything happy and sunshine if we could. And the writers are going through this stuff. I mean, we're watching all these events, just as Charmaine said on the set, we are in the writer's room, and it's kind of, sometimes you even have to pull yourself back from the emotion of the moment, because what is it gonna be 2 to 3 months from now when it's broadcast?
And it's interesting that you bring up that this is the 1 year anniversary. At that point, we were not filming. However, the writer's room was going on, and we had to pause the writer's room because many people were in New York, and not only were people so devastated by the news, but also there were firecrackers going off every night. People weren't sleeping either. So there was simply no work for at least a week.
Yeah, it's been interesting. I've talked to various showrunners and things like that, and a lot of people had to pause for a minute, especially people of color, because as much as we've seen videos of Philando Castile or Tamir Rice or other people, it was different. This George Floyd video was different in a way. Mm-hmm. So you know what?
May I say for
please, a moment, please.
Sorry to interrupt, but
please.
I think. Just the atmosphere, as everyone says, is leading the action of what our actions as human beings should be, that we are in a Black law firm on television, that it's a mixed group of races that are writers and people getting along together. Clearly, those of us in the communication business, all kinds of communication business, have an incredible platform to try to wake people up about systemic racism that is at an absolute tipping point because of the loss of George Floyd's life. And it isn't those only here in these squares and in the writer's room and everybody involved with The Good Fight and other shows that have similar opportunities, but anybody watching at home, whatever you do, you can wake yourself up, you can wake your family up, your friends, your neighbors, wherever you go, and do what you can to move this ball forward. They're doing it in this show. I was privileged to be in one scene where something happens that is right to the nervous center of what you're talking about. And that's a privilege to be a part of a moment that is, I believe, a too long coming necessary change for the survival of our country.
That's amazing, and it's great that the show is able to take advantage of that, and provide scenes that will talk about these issues. I mean, I seem to remember that the first episode of The Good Fight, you guys had to change some lines in it because you thought Hillary Clinton was going to win, right? Trump.
Surprise!
Yes, we did.
So you had a little more time.
Filming the scene that we filmed on election night was when he comes to my office to offer me a place at the law firm, and I'm rock bottom, and he comes in, and he did all his coverage early in the evening, and at that point nobody was really thinking, you know, okay, we don't have to check. And I remember at around 8 o'clock at night, they were turning the cameras around, which always takes at least 20 minutes to a half hour. So I went to my room and checked my phone, and it was the New York Times had called the election for Trump. You couldn't believe the atmosphere on the set. It's like it's like a bomb drop. People went so quiet and we just tried to get through our work. And it was like the earth moved, didn't it? I mean, it was extraordinary. And yes, we had to change the narrative. But boy, did he provide raw material and raw emotion, didn't he, Robert and Michelle? He was a character in the show.
Christine.
Exactly. Well, that's what I wanted to ask, because you had a little more notice this time, but I can guess how you might feel about the future of the country now that he's no longer president, but what about the show? is the show gonna be held back a little because your starring character, your starring Oscar?
I know, it's a great relief we don't have to play anymore about him. Frankly, I think this season's going to be fantastic.
I do think this season is influenced by January 6th more than anything.
Yes.
And a sense that the country, you know, it doesn't really heal. It's kind of broken up a bit. And is there any way to bring it back together? And I do think that is the, you know, looking outside of the law firm towards Mandy's part and what's going on there, it's a question of, does the country have any ability to bring itself together, or will it always kind of fracture up more and more?
Right.
Yeah,
right.
The Trump shadow is definitely, we're still in his dark shadow. So it's not like he just went away and it's now everything's fine. there's plenty of raw emotion, as you said, with racial issues and the polarity and polarization of our politics.
Well, I have to say I'm not involved in every storyline. I'm just involved in the storylines that I'm involved in. But it has been a lovely oasis void of that unmentionable for me. And I couldn't be happier. I don't think I've heard his name mentioned once in any scene I'm in, and I just love it.
You joined the show at the right time, my man. That's all I can say.
That's right.
So the pandemic did force a lot of TV shows to scramble. You guys had your previous season cut short, right? So can you talk a little bit about sort of figuring out how to come back through the pandemic, and also whether you learned anything during the pandemic that might help you as you go forward, even as we seem to be kind of coming out of it?
Yes, it was difficult. We have very good line producers on the two shows we were doing three shows during the pandemic about how to test during COVID. You know, the testing is done 3 times a week on anybody who's taking their mask off or anybody around those people. And it seems to be a system that's working very well. If there's a positive of any kind test, then everybody around them is contact traced to see where they are. And the show could shut down for 2 weeks. We never really shut down after we started up again for more than, I think, 3 or 4 days as we contact traced. But it's kind of a real testament to Brooke Kenny, our line producer, and Nancy Herman, who really found a way to bring the show to a safe place where we can make it. And
I would add that it's also a testament to the unions of Hollywood, yeah, because they were determined, SAG was right out front, that people needed to be safe. And as a result, there are these protocols that, you know, have left the sets to be safer than the world around them for much of this pandemic, which was pretty extraordinary.
And as to what we've learned, I think what we mostly learned was the writer's room, how it could work with people at home, because a lot of people are traveling a little distance to get to the writer's room. And editing, we have a lot of editors we left on the West Coast, and now we use them because you can use East Coast and West Coast. So Zoom, you know, we have a very jokey part where Christine's character has to tell all the people to download this new program called Zoom.com, and we're going to ABR it, Christine, where you have to spell it Z-O-O-M, because it would be such a new thing on that first day. But now, obviously, I mean, how could we live? So we make a lot of fun of technology, but technology made this last year, you know, except for all the militia stuff online and everything like that.
Right.
But, you know, our ability to work together is all based a little on technology falling into place.
So And speaking of the pandemic, Christine, you and Audra had this sort of viral sensation during the pandemic with your Ladies Who Lunch video, which was just amazing.
Christine's fault.
Were you surprised by how people responded to that? And what's, I know you were, I think it was kind of, was it connected to charity as well? Talk a little
yes,
bit about
indeed. It. Yes, indeed. It was connected. It raised a lot of money, and it was Steve Sondheim's 90th birthday celebration, which was done virtually. So when Audra was in her house and I was in my back office at my country home and Meryl was in her house, and we said, how do you know, oh my gosh, this is going to end our careers, right, Audra? We remember that phone call. We're like, I don't think we shouldn't, are we really going to do this? And
we literally said, this is going to end our careers. We literally said that.
Why would you think that? It was so wonderful.
Because we're still actors at heart. We're still insecure actors.
But see, we weren't singing together. We just did our separate parts and, you know, with our glasses and our bottles. And I don't know about Audra, but I was howling, you know, drink to that. At night with my grandchildren sleeping not far away, thinking, oh, what's wrong with grandma? She just keeps bellowing like that. Is she drunk? I mean, it was just, the whole thing was comical. I'm delighted with the response. Yeah.
And you two are not the only viral stars in the cast now, Mr. Patinkin. You and your wife also took off by virtue of your TikTok videos during the pandemic. And I'm wondering, I mean, it seems like the ultimate lesson from both of these videos is that even a global pandemic can't stop creativity. And I wonder if you feel that way.
Nothing can stop creativity. Every human being has it within them. It's part of breathing. And it's always been essential and necessary. We certainly experienced the necessity of it this past year in endless varieties of ways. But I won't get into a specific thing that I just went through, but our lives are dependent on creativity and using the creative force to come up with better ideas to exist as a human race. And the fact that we have the privilege to be in a storytelling business is, I don't think any of us realize how lucky we were, even when we started. I don't, you just say, I want to do that. I want to be a part of telling stories. I'll never forget when I was a kid doing Carousel, in the same room I went to nursery school in, this guy, Bob Condor, who ran the nursery program, he asked everybody, what's this play about? And people said, it's about a guy who makes a mistake, about a guy who goes to heaven, about a guy who does this, about a guy. And like a great teacher, he says, well, I think you're all right. I think it's about all those things. And then he said, I also think it's about something else. I think it's about if you love someone, tell them. And at that moment, I thought, I'd heard my rabbi make great sermons my whole life. My parents said nice things around the dinner table. But that connected with me. It was available. I could just handle it. And at that moment, I went, if that's what this thing called theater is like, this, I'm hanging out for this. And so I think we have all worked our butts off to save each other's lives in endless ways. It continues, it will continue. And we're also damn lucky to be alive, for God's sake. And let's not have a moment go by in any kind of gathering where we don't encourage people to get vaccinated. Those that have, you know, conditions that they can't do that, we understand, but the scientists are working on that too. And many conditions now can be vaccinated. And it's essential that everyone talk to everyone, even those who push back against it. You know, get the facts, call up, find the facts, put them in your notebook, learn them, and just push right back again. You're saving human lives. It's worth it. If somebody gets angry with you, it'll be worth it.
Yep, most definitely. And we need to have Broadway come back. We need to have the TV industry come back. We need to have journalists come back. And the only way that happens is if people get vaccinated, definitely. So I wanted to ask one last question that I hope each of you will feel comfortable tackling. But, you know, I have always said that the good fight almost felt like the Black show that nobody thought was the Black show. and you guys were indeed ahead of the curve in terms of diversity and tackling subjects involving race on television. So I wanted to ask you what you think you might have learned about race, or what you think you might have, some revelation, something that came to you in working on this show and talking about these issues, particularly at this time. And of course, we could start with Robert and Michelle, but if anyone else wants to take that, I'd love to hear it.
There was an ATA movement against the agents. It was the writers firing all their agents because sure. The agents were taking packaging fees. And I was surprised when that happened that we got our most diverse writers' room ever. And so what surprised me is you would think the opposite. In fact, agents were saying, don't fire your agents because how are you gonna find the untapped talent? Where are you gonna find the diverse talent? And I think what was amazing is that didn't happen, the reverse happened. So Michelle might be right, we have to wait for 2 years to see what happens. But in the moment when there was not a gatekeeper of some kind, actually you were looking for talent. You weren't looking for someone new or anything like that. So that was one thing I learned. Now that goes back, what was that, about a year and a quarter ago? So, but anyway, that was the only thing.
That's interesting.
Yeah, and you're not the only showrunner who said that to me, by the way.
Which is weird, isn't it? I mean,
it's not weird to me because you're absolutely right. Once the gatekeepers are gone and you can really consider people, then you're not distracted by this, we're talking about systemic oppression, right? You're not distracted by that. You're able to just find great talent wherever you can find it.
Yes.
And I was just wondering if anyone else wanted to share anything?
I do.
Just want to make this show that we're all privileged to do as comfortable a place as possible and as welcoming a place as possible. I consider myself so blessed to be surrounded by my colleagues, my Black colleagues, and so gifted and so just a revelation to me. But being an artist, you have the great good fortune of working with, but this, at this moment in time, I'm just very happy that this show is right there at the epicenter of a kind of awareness that we need to have in the culture.
Now, Audra, raise your hand and then we'll go to Mandy. Audra?
Yeah, I think the only thing I was gonna say as a Black actor, you do forget how often you're usually in white space. And it's been magnified because so often on set, we're in Black space. And that is revelatory to the point where, there have been times where it's only been Christine and then everybody else around her is Black. And so often it's the other way around. It's flipped where it's only Audra who's Black, or it's only Charmaine who's Black or whatever. But in this case, it's the absolute opposite. And that's been a gift. It's a gift. I hope that continues. But I do have to say that on this show, it has been an absolute gift.
And Mandy?
I thank God at this moment in time that I am in a show that focuses on a Black law firm to change the paradigm, hopefully forever, in some small way that will ripple.
But I will say the show, as serious as it sounds, is hopefully a lot of fun. What you have with everyone you're seeing, Charmaine, all of us, there's a comedic element to it. So we take what we think are serious subjects and find what we think is a comic spin, even in the darkest moments. Because there's some things, as Manny was pointing out, it's hard to find any comedy in. It's nice to see a group of people working together away, but also the writers are often trying to find ways that you're entertained, because we are doing an entertainment too. And yes, that's, sir, I think, one of those tensions in the works.
Of course. Yeah, and I just wanted to add in my two cents on what I learned as well, just to touch on Robert's note, is that I think I'm referencing a line from last episode. I like the way that the writers treat the Black experience with such nuance and not in a monolithic way. And I feel like always, especially as a Black person, always in the news, we hear about the oppression and the painful parts. But I think this show also shows a lot of success on screen and a lot of hope and a lot of prospering and a lot of lightness as well, which I think, especially as a younger Black person, I think is just as important too.
Thank you. Thank you. And, you know, it is important to remember that, you know, as much as we enjoy the conversations that are happening in this fictional world, there are real life things going on that we also have to pay attention to. So thank you, Mandy.
Absolutely.
You said as well. So we've run out of time, man. I could talk to you guys for the rest of the day. I'm sure you don't want to, but I could, because I am such a huge fan of the show, and I'm a huge fan of each of you. And I can't wait to see what you bring us in this upcoming fifth season. But we have to close it here. So I want to thank co-creators and executive producers Robert and Michelle King, stars Christine Baranski, Audra McDonald, and new cast additions Mandy Patinkin and Charmaine Bingwa for joining us in this discussion about the fifth season of The Good Fight, which you can see beginning on June 24th on Paramount Plus. So thanks a lot, and thanks for tuning into this video for the ATX Festival. We really appreciate your patronage, and we're looking forward to bringing the festival to you in person next year in Austin.
So, Eric, can I just have a last quickie? Can I say one last thing here? I thank God for this show, because there's a lot of things that go on in this world that make me, you know, just the way you've seen me get, you know, over issues. And this show is first and foremost an entertaining, fun system. And it has saved my life at this particular time on a variety of levels. And that is what we all need. And it is a gift to be able to laugh at some of the darkest stuff that we live with, and these guys know how to do it.
Yeah, and you know, to be nominated for a Nobel Prize would be nice. And we're not saying that everybody needs to send in it, but it's easy to nominate someone. Anybody can do it. Okay.
Yeah. Do you have the address with you, Robert?
I'll put it on the screen. Hold on.
Well, I got to say, you know, Mandy's passion is the thing that he's most known for as a performer. So I'm enjoying experiencing it firsthand. Thank you very much, sir. And thanks to all of you for joining us.
Thank you for your questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.